So thank you very much for the invitation and for the proposition of this lecture on optical interferometry. So so during these days I will speak about optical interferometry and the application of optical interferometry to stellar astrophysics. So it will be more general introduction to this observing technique of optical interferometry with the hope that we will, in the future, apply for observing time on an interferometer, either on the VLTI or on the shallow array. There is open time access for everybody on the planet, so there's good opportunity for making interesting observation. So the cycle of the lecture will be that today I will speak mainly about the principle and the reality of what is optical interferometry, and I will conclude by the short history of the development of this observing technique from the very beginning. Tomorrow we see what are the current development, the recent development on optical interferometry and the main science program that has developed with this installation on the wall. On Wednesday, we will try to have a practical session with practical exercise so that you become familiar with the interesting tools that have been developed in the recent decades by the community for preparing interferometric observation and for doing simple analysis. So there will be some example, and you will work, and I will listen to you mainly on Wednesday. And on Thursday, I will speak about the future development, the new instrument that I am developing for the char array, and for the long term, what we are considering for the future of optical interferometry. So as an introduction, the usual stellar astrophysics is mainly, you know, astrometry, you know, spectroscopy, photometry, polarimetry, but in all these observing techniques, stars are considered as point-like source. So you don't care about the brightness distribution of the star, you just look at the quantity of flux, the spectral distribution of flux, the time distribution of flux, and you have absolutely no information on the brightness distribution. This is where the high angular resolution is bringing new information. If you look at this highly resolved image of the surface of the star, of the sun, you can see that there is a lot to understand with such image. And the goal of optical interferometry is to obtain image of star like this image of the sun. So you can learn about rotation, you can learn about pulsation, spots, variability, you can also learn for hot star, about winds, for mass loss, for electric stars. And what we need is, of course, we need high resolution, high spatial resolution, in order to have detail on the surface of stars. And we need also to have, as soon as you start having high spatial resolution, you should think also in terms of high temporal resolution. Because if the star is rotating, you change every time you are looking at the star, the star is changing. And we see example tomorrow of a program that have taken benefit of the rotation of the star, for example, for imaging spots on the surface of stars. We need also spectral resolution, because usually this is an image, of course, with a HR filter, and an interferometer is like an imaging telescope. It's nothing else than an imaging telescope with a very high angular resolution. Usually when you have a telescope, you put an instrument. With an interferometer, you also put an instrument, which is a spectrograph or an imager, an imaging camera. But usually you combine the interferometric observation with a spectrograph. And of course, to obtain very nice images like this one, you need a very good management of the field of view in your instrument and of the transfer function. The transfer function, I will speak later on what it is, but it is the way you can illustrate the imaging property of the telescope. So here is a kind of zoo of images of stars that we have seen. So you see, that's for the last 10 years, typically, or even more, 20 years, I would say. You see that from the very beginning, we have models, or this is not a model, in fact, this is reconstructed images. But here we have more images that have been observed with different interferometers, either the Char Array, the Mark II interferometer, the GI2T. All the interferometers have produced this kind of images. So that's the very beginning, in fact. You see that the details are, of course, not as nice as the detail we can have on the sun, because of the difficult the size of the star. But we need, you see, we start to have image of stars. So what is the difficulty? If you look at the distribution of the different astrophysical sources as a function of their dimension and their distances, and if you look, for example, here you have a giant star, you have main sequence stars, here you have accretion disk in enclosed binary, and if you look at the classical angular resolution of a ground telescope or of the best space telescope today, or even on the ground with a nice adaptive optic system, you see that this is the current limit on ground for the biggest telescope. So it means that you start to resolve a little bit of a few giant stars, but almost you see all the other objects as point-like sources. There is no details with a single telescope. If you go with the aperture synthesis technique, you gain a factor 100 in angular resolution, so going from 1 meter telescope to 100 meter telescope give you access to a large number of details. And of course, if you can go further up to 1 micro arc, you can see detail on white dwarf, for example. The difficulty, so you see that the main objects are very small in the sky, so you need very high angular resolution to see details on the surface of star. But when you look at detail on the surface of star, of course, you should consider that you have not the integrated flux of the object, but the flux per resolution element. So it's why it's difficult when you increase the angular resolution on an object, you need to increase the sensitivity. Even on bright star, if you want to make an image with 100 by 100 pixels, you need a high sensitivity because you will have very small flux in each resolution element. So that this diagram is giving you some information. If you look at stars with a 10 microarc second resolution, for a star that should be a magnitude 3 or 4, in fact, at 10 microarc second, it corresponds to a star of magnitude 10 or 12. So it's much, much more difficult. So what we see here is that the stars are very small. So how can we measure a very small angular diameter? So that's very simple, in fact, in principle, by looking at the very basic equation. When you have a star of angular diameter theta, and it's seen on the Earth by a screen that has a radius L. So that defines a solid angle, omega, which is equal to p theta over 2 to the square, and the étendue of the beam here is equal to the solid angle multiplied by the surface of the screen. And there is an important relation given by Goodman in his book about colorants. It says that the étendue of the beam should be smaller than the square of the wavelength. And that's defined what is called the coherence of the wavelength. And if you look at number, in fact, for this, if you use this equation and you estimate what is the radius on the ground on Earth that define a coherence for a star of 10 milliard seconds of angular diameter and the wavelength of 1 micron, 1 micron, it gives you a radius of 13 meters. It means that if you look on the ground for a star that has a 10 milliard second angular diameter, you will see some coherence between the wave that you collect at this point and the wave that you collect 10 meters apart. But if you go further, the coherence is degrading. Okay? So that's the first way of doing that. The second way is, of course, to compute what is the coherence of the wavefront, which is defined by the complex degree of mutual coherence between 2 points of the collecting error. So you are measuring the flux the intensity of the complex wave here at point one, at point two, and you compute this quantity that is called the complex degree of mutual coherence. And there is a very important theorem, the von Sitter-Zernike theorem, indicating that this quantity is equal to the modulus of the Fourier transform of the object brightness distribution. So it means that if you measure the coherence between these two points, you are measuring one component of the Fourier transform of the object. And again, it gives you, in fact, this quantity for a uniform disk. This is the Fourier transform, give you this function, which is a Bessel function, and we will see later what is equivalent. And if you make again this numerical application, you can see that this quantity here should be equal to 0.5. This is the definition of the coherence by Goodman, and you obtain exactly the same quantity if you put gamma 1 equal 0.5. So that's another way to use the definition of the angular diameter. So the problem is that when you are measuring this quantity, you see that the coherence radius is 13 meters, but the coherence time is very, very small because of the wavelengths, of course. So if we use larger wavelengths, if you go in the radio domain, in the radio or millimetric domain, and you use fast detector, in fact, it is possible to record the electromagnetic wave directly on each telescope, and then you correlate in the computer. So the first equation here, you can do it in the computer if you go to larger wavelength and fast detector. So that's the domain of radio interferometry, of very long baseline interferometry. The second way is that if you use wavelengths typically at 10 micron or 20 micron on the ground, and you use very small spectral bandwidth, fast detector again, you can you record not only you do not record electromagnetic wave directly, so you don't save the phase of the electromagnetic wave, but you can create beating waves, record them, and then you can correlate this beating wave in the computer. That's the domain of heterodyne interferometry, which were used in the past on the Morrison Observatory at 10 micron, but it's no longer used because it was necessary to use very small spectral bandwidth for doing that kind of interferometry, and therefore it was really not sensitive at all. The best way, in fact, is to make this equation directly in your optical instrument by combining directly the electromagnetic wave collected by the two telescopes and make direct interference. You don't record the wave at each telescope. You send the beam directly to a common detector and you record the interferometric signal. So you don't need to record it. There is a last interesting point is that it can be shown also that the currents here could be computed not only with the complex quantity here, but with the intensity and the variation of the intensity. So if you measure the fluctuation of the intensity of one telescope and the fluctuation of the intensity of the second telescope, you can have a relation giving you also what is called the correlation between the fluctuation of the intensity. That's the domain of the intensity interferometry. This one is also very strongly limited in magnitude because you have to go very fast and you have also to use small spectral bandwidth. So what is the ideal interferometer for the moment? If you want to work in the optical domain, that will be this way, this one. So what do we do, in fact? So we have our interferometer and we directly form the recombination of the two complex amplitudes. But we measure it on a single detector. So the detector that we have in the optical domain are of course sensitive to the intensity. So we form the intensity of the square of the sum of the complex amplitude, and we put in fact a term of phase here, I will explain that later. Just to have a modulation of the signal, it could be a modulation either on the image plane or in the on a time modulation, so that you modulate the signal. So if you develop this equation, you obtain this one, where you can see an equation with 1 plus something multiplied by cos theta, which is in fact a modulation. And this modulation is what we call the fringes. And we have in fact many terms in this equation. We have a multiplying factor in front of the cosinus that generate the modulation. And there is 2 terms. The first term, it just consider the intensity of the. It means that if you have different intensity in your telescope, then you have a degraded contrast of fringes. This term is what we call the contrast. If you have this term is you will see later that is between 0 and 1. If you have this term is equal to 0, then you have no modulation, of course, which is just equal to 1. If the maximum of contrast, then you have nice fringes with the high modulation. So if you have not the same flux on the two telescopes, you degrade the contrast by a factor. But of course, in an interferometer, you can measure the intensity of each telescope and compensate for this term. And that's very interesting because here we see a modulation term that is the complex degree of coherence measure. We see it. And then measuring the contrast of the fringes gives you a measure of one component of one spatial frequency of the object. So, what we have seen for the moment? We have seen that for doing interferometry, we need to understand what is the coherence of a stellar waveform. We need to understand what is the Fourier transform and the brightness distribution, and we need to know what is the spatial frequency that we analyze on the source. So the method is mainly using the complex degree of mutual coherence. You have not to compute it, in fact. It's done directly by the combination of the beams on the interferometer. So you see that may appear quite complicated. So, but in fact, there is another point of view, which we call the object-image relationship. And it's why, at the beginning, I tell you that an interferometer is just an imaging telescope with a special pupil, of course. It's not a single monolithic mirror, but it's also a telescope with a diluted pupil. And all the techniques, the equation that apply for the image relation, the object-image relation, can apply for an interferometer. So there are three main equations. So there is the distribution. The brightness distribution of the image here is obtained from the brightness distribution of the source, the object here, by what we call, in fact, the point spread function. And if you transform this equation by Fourier transform here, you obtain the spatial frequency of the image, and you determine the spatial frequency of the image from the spatial frequency of the object. This is where you are interested, by a quantity that is called the optical transfer function. And this optical transfer function for an interferometer is just a kind of a spatial filter. Okay? And this modulation transfer function is can be computed as the modulus of the optical transfer function, which we call the modulation transfer function, can be calculated as the autocorrelation of the pupil function. The pupil function is the position of the mirror of the interferometer. So all these equations have been well understood for single telescope. Now it's also understood for interferometer. So how does it work? If you look at a telescope with a mirror, a pupil of 2 meters, for example, you see the point spread function. This is what we call classically the eridisc, the point spread function. This is, of course, without turbulence, with no aberration. But that's the principle. If you increase the pupil size, then you see that the point spread function is becoming smaller and smaller. Okay, and that's the improvement of the angular resolution of the telescope, because here you have a point spread function that is very very sharp and you will see nice detail of the object. If now you are going to an interferometer, so here is the point spread function of one single telescope. And you have two telescopes working as an interferometer. Here you see that you have almost the same envelope of the, as if you have only one telescope, but you see the modulation in the point spread function. So in that, in the direction of the baseline, what we call the baseline is the distance between the two telescopes, you see that this is more result, in fact. And you have a better resolution in the direction of the baseline. In the other direction, if you look in that direction here, you have exactly the same resolution as in this case. Of course, if you have a telescope now, you have the third telescope, you see that the point spread function is changing. I have 4, 5, 6, 8, 7, 8, 15. And you see here that with 15 telescopes, I have, of course, I have some small peaks here, but I have a very bright peak at the center, giving you the point spread function of an equivalent mirror given by the size of the array. It means that this point spread function is the same as if I have a big giant mirror of this size. So of course I do not have the same collecting area, but I have the same resolving power. So the idea of interferometry is just to doing that. So there is also a way to improve the quality of this transfer function, in fact. Just also because of the way you are combining your telescope in the interferometer. For example, if you use the VLTI with 4 8-meter telescope and 4 2-meter telescope, you see that the quality of the point spread function is not very nice. If you use a special combining scheme where you allow to zoom to each of the pupil in your optical instrument, which is fine, you do not change the relative position of beams, but you change the size of each beam, and you can improve the quality. So that's the way all the interferometric instruments are working. You are not just looking at what we call the Fizeau combination, but we are doing what we call the Michelson, or what was designed, what was defined later on by Antoine Lambéry as the densifier combination of beams, where you densify your output pupil, also keeping the same intrans pupil. In the Fizeau mode, you have the same output pupil that the input pupil, but in the interferometric instrument, you can play with that. So there is an important aspect in interferometer is the support of the modulation transfer function, which is the autocorrelation of the pupil function, and this is what we call the UV plane. And the UV plane is something that is very interesting, but because it is very important, because it gives you the way your interferometer at for one observation will look at the object. So there is some nice tool existing for the community. So you will practice that tomorrow, but I want to introduce you some of these tools. So this is a numerical simulator called ASPO. And that has a lot of collection of all the interferometer in the world have been modelized by this tool. So you can here select your target. This is, for example, the star Regulus, very bright star. You can select your instrument, and you see here what is the UV plane. So the UV plane here. So this is in meter. This is for the chiral array. You have the dimension in meter, or also in a wave number here. And all the tracks here are where you will measure. How do you sample your Fourier transform of the object? And the image you see below it's the Fourier transform of the object. It means that here, for example, we can, with this future instrument on the char array, we will see a very large number of information on this object, because we are sampling not only the center of the object, but we are sampling very far away. If we look at, for example, at the different interferometer, if we go to the VLTI, this is the same object, and you see, for example, that this instrument is working in the H band with much smaller baseline, because it's on the VLTI, the baseline are limited to 100 meters. And you see here that you will not see as many detail. If you put the same dimension of plot here, you see that we are now looking at the very center of the object, and we are not resolving very well this object. Of course, if you go to another instrument, for example, the new Matisse instrument in the 10 micron regime, you see that this is really not an object that is well adapted for this instrument, Matisse. This object is very small. It's a 1.3 milliarc second star. It's clearly for visible observation, not for infrared observation. By the way, this could be a very good calibrator for this infrared observation. Okay, so now coming back to my presentation. So that's a short summary of what has been done for interferometry. So I told you that it's equivalent to a giant mirror, but in fact we are now working with separate telescope and direct combination. So the first experiment was made by Stefan at the Marseille Observatory on a single telescope with a mask. The major step was obtained by Michelson at the Mont-Wilson Observatory with the famous Michelson stellar interferometer with a 20 feet support on top of the 100-inch telescope at Mont-Wilson. And there is two fixed mirrors here and two movable mirrors. And you can change the baseline. That was the first very nice experiment made by Michelson in 1920. And then the major step was obtained in 1974 by Antoine Laberry, where for the first time we obtained fringes with two separate telescopes, like in this one. So that's the major step. So as I told you, if you look at this principle of interferometer, which is very equivalent to this one, in fact, this is what we call the FISO combination. Here is more the Michelson combination, because you can imagine here that you have, like in the Michelson experiment, the output baseline here is smaller than the input baseline. This is just a way of encoding the information. You change the apparent baseline for the eyepiece that is here, but you are encoding an information for a larger baseline. In this FISO interferometer, you have directly the output, the input baseline as the baseline forming the fringes. That's very important to understand. So, but in fact, in principle, you see that this system are most similar in terms of light collection. And that's also important to consider that if you multiply the number of small mirrors here, you will progressively generate the equivalent big parabolic telescope as a function of the sound goal you want. For example, here, the best images for the cluster of stars is given by this one, because it improves the high spatial frequency. This one, the image of the spotter star is better here, because you have a lot of redundancy in the array of telescope, and it highly improves the quality of the point space function with very small artifacts. Here you see bright artifacts, here also. Here in the center you have very bright spot. Yeah. And that's very useful for this kind of images. So So we can define a number of criteria on the point state function, either the uncircled energy, the Fourier Saffat maximum, and also for interferometer, it's very important to have this to define this quantity that is called the halo, and this generated by this artifact. This is very important for imaging properties. So there have been many studies about that, with, for example, what is called the encircled energy for the different kind of interferometer, or the interferometric field, which is the number of element of resolution that you can get as a function of number of telescope. So a classical way of thinking in terms of an image is that you, if you have n telescope, you have a n by n image at the end. So today you see that with interferometer with four or six telescopes, the image is quite poor. So you multiply the number of observations, you wait for the time for the Earth's rotation, and the Earth's rotation make the baseline, the apparent baseline changing for your object. So you multiply the information that's at the end, and that's the reason why, for example, the ALMA array is very powerful in terms of imaging, because combining 50 or 60 antenna at the same time give you very high quality in the interferometric resolution. So now we will go a little bit more in terms of reality of interferometry, because in the future maybe we will consider interferometer as direct imaging system, but for the moment that's clearly, we continue to speak about fringes, visibilities. So that's of course the problem of coherence, and I will explain that, but also it's a budget issue, because building an array of 60 telescopes of 8 meters costs a lot. So what is the coherence? So we already speak about this equation at the beginning, but you see that if you have a coherence time of this quantity as calculated before, it means that we have a coherence length of 10 microns. So it means that to get correct coherence, you need to regularize the optical path with such an accuracy, which is 10 microns. And you see that you need to introduce delay line in one of the beam to compensate the delay, so that at the center of your interferometer, you have fringes here that you have compensated to set the path by the delay. And of course, as the star is moving on the sky, this angle is changing all the time. So the delay is changing all the time. And the delay is changing by typically for 100 meter baseline, it's at a speed of 1 millimeter per second typically. So you need very complex design. This is what we call the delay line. So you have an example here on the VLTI. This is example of the on the Chandra array. And here is another example with a fisheye eyepiece objective for the Coana experiment that was on the Mauna Kea Observatory for combining by fiber many large telescopes. Here on the Chandra array, we have here the six delay line here, the six cards are here, and we have 44 meters here. On the VLTI, the tunnel is very long also, it's under the mountain. The tunnel is more than 50 meters apart to compensate for the delay, because you need to have, when you look at star different position in the sky, you need to compensate. So that's the first difficulty. The second difficulty of the coherence, if you solve the first one, which is just an engineering problem, you have a problem with the atmospheric turbulence, because the atmosphere of Earth is changing a lot with a gradient of temperature that generates turbulence, and that turbulence generates a degradation of the coherence. So typically, in the correct condition in an observatory, the coherence of the wavefront coming through the Earth's atmosphere is typically of 10 centimeters. So it's much less than the 13 meters that we have calculated just before. So the atmospheric turbulence is completely broken the coherence of the waveform. And also temporally, this is very short. And also we have a spectral extension of the coherence in the domain. So there is a lot of variation, and the complexity is that when you are looking at the fringe at the end, you are looking at a function of time, of space, and of wavelength. So that's very highly dependent of turbulence, and it's why for the moment the interferometers are mainly developed in the infrared domain, where the turbulence is much smaller. So you can have in the infrared, you can have a spatial coherence of 1 meter, or a temporal coherence of 20 or 50 milliseconds, which is much better. These numbers are in the visible, which is very, very difficult. So of course, the solution would be to go to space. So there has been a number of space projects that have been developed the last 10 to 20 years, and it was mainly guided to exoplanet characterization, not only detection, but characterization, imaging exoplanet, star and exoplanet. But all this program, either from the US side or from the European side, have been canceled. And at that time, there is almost no project for space interferometer. So that will come maybe a new days, but for the moment, there is no project. So of course, the difficulty for this space project was the formation flying concept. You need to send at the same time a certain number of completely independent satellites and make them working all together with an accuracy of less than 1 millimeter. So on the ground, what we are doing is we are looking on real time to the fringes. And so there is nice fringes here, and you see two things. There is the envelope of the fringes, what is called the group delay, and you have the phase here. If you see the phase, the fringe moving, you can measure a phase. So there is two concepts for stabilizing the fringes and improving the coherences by looking at this group delay or the phase delay. There is an example of what we did on the GI2T interferometer, looking at dispersal fringes, give you an information on the optical path difference. And you can see a small modulation. This is real data, where you see the fringe moving as a time working, as time is running. And the goal is to look at the position of the peak, giving you the optical path difference, and give a feedback to the delay line to stabilize the peak. If you do that in real time, then you can stabilize your peak and you can integrate for a long time. That's the principle of fringe tracking. So these fringe tracking are working now on the VLTI. They have been able to make very long integration, so with a coherence time of 10 milliseconds on the VLTI, that succeed to make exposure time of a few minutes, thanks to this exceptional fringe tracking system. So the fringe tracker are now more and more developed on the interferometer. There will be one that we will install next year on the Chandra array. And the new instrument also on the VLTI, Matisse, I will speak tomorrow about that, will be also equipped with a fringe tracker. If you do not have a fringe tracker, so you need to make short exposure, and in fact it's like a telescope without adaptive optics, because the fringe tracker for an interferometer is like an adaptive optics for a single telescope. It corrects the error of the waveforms. So if you do not have this fringe tracker, it's like you were working with a telescope without an adaptive optics system. Okay. So, again, this scheme. I tell you that an interferometer is like a telescope. Well, this is not completely true. If you look at this interferometer, the theoretical one, then everything is flowing to the star. That's an interferometer that is very much like a telescope. This is the Fizeau convention. But here, in this system, the two telescopes are looking at the star. And this is not moving. So that's a big difference, because the pupil plane here is moving. Here, the pupil plane is on the ground. It's not moving. So there is a big difference here. And that's why in an interferometer, you need a lot for the moment, because there will be solution in the future, but for the moment, to combine the telescope in that way, you need a lot of optics to get the beams coming from the star out from the telescope and going to the combining lab and to the instrument. So that is, for example, the optical scheme of the VLTA. You see something very complex. Charline array is the same. And if you look correctly from the telescope with the first mirror M1 and the output of the instrument here, you have 60 mirrors to transport the beam from the star to the beam combining lab. And of course you have again here new optics for preparing the beams for the instrument. So that's very complex things. When you have the beams coming to your instrument, after the GD line, everything is good. You have the correct wavefronts with all the correction that are needed. And you have two ways of encoding the fringes. Doing this equation, you can do it either by considering temporal modulation of the phase here. So we make a combination of the two beams here on the beam splitter with two outputs on 2 pixels of a detector, single pixel of a detector, and you have here a modulation that generates an optical path length difference that generates this term, and you have the fringes, what we call the temporal sampling. The other way is the multi-axial combination, so you make just a direct combination here, and you zoom the image here, and you can see the fringes in the image plane. So this is more the domain of image plane interferometry with spatial sampling, and you sample the fringes by sampling the pixel of the detector. Here you have a single pixel, but you sample the fringes by the time. So with all these things, we can measure the fringe contrast. That's this equation. So in principle, the fringe contrast, this term, can be computed by the quantity, the max of the intensity minus the mean of the intensity divided by the sum of the max and the mean, and it gives you this term. Everything is removed if you suppose that this one is equal to 1. But in fact, this is really not practical because fringes are moving a lot. So there is a better way to do that. It's to do the Fourier transform of this equation. Again, Fourier transform. And in the Fourier transform, you have one single peak corresponding to this modulation that gives you a measurement of the contrast here. And this contrast is, of course, related to the complex degree of mutual coherence and the fringe contrast. So we can measure the contrast so that we can measure the modulus of the Fourier transform. We can also measure the phase of the Fourier transform because this is really important. So you can measure the phase of the Fourier transform if your object has a phase, and you can do that by what we call the differential phase, which is looking at two different wavelengths, and you can eliminate everything, and you got just the difference of phase between the two wavelengths, which is also something very interesting. The best way that have been used and that is defined by a radio astronomer is what we call the closure phase. So you have three telescopes. You have the phase due to the atmospheric turbulence on each telescope, phi1, phi2, and phi3. And what you want to measure is the phase of the object on this baseline, this baseline, and this baseline. But of course, the phase on this baseline is corrupted by the atmospheric phase here. But if you combine these three equations here by measuring the phase on the first baseline, second and third baseline, there is a combination, and you can, by summing these three phases, you obtain, in fact, directly, you suppress, in fact, the atmospheric phase, and you got an information on the sum of the three phases. So that's very interesting because this is a way of removing the atmospheric turbulence on the phase measurement. So at the end, what do we have with an interferometer? We have three kinds of data: the square visibility, the modulus of the Fourier transform, a quantity that is called the differential phase, which is very interesting for objects that have a spectral behavior, a shape that is changing with the spectrum, for example, a rotating star or a star with an envelope where the disk is emitting in a spectral line. That you can have very nice information from the sensor, the differential phase and the phase closure. So how much of this data do we get for one observation? For a two-telescope interferometer, you only get one V-square. For a three-telescope interferometer, we get three V-square and one closure phase. And if you generalize that, you see that for an interferometer with n telescope, you have n minus m1, n times n minus 1, so over two bases. So in fact, you have n minus multiplied by n minus 1 unknown, which because you are measuring complex quantity. So that's this curve here in light blue. And what you are measuring, in fact, is a number of modulus, a number of closure, a number of modulus, a number of closure, and you see that the total here is improving, of course, the percentage of the unknown that you can measure. You see that with two telescopes, you only measure 50% of your information. With a six telescope interferometer, you already measure something like 85% of the observation. So you just observe a second time with a different configuration, and you can recover the maximum of the information. Of course, going further, we improve the quality of the information. there is an interesting thing, in fact, because when I define the interferometric observable, I tell you that you have to make the Fourier transform of the fringes. So you have the fringes here, you make the Fourier transform, so you measure the quantity that is related to the Fourier transform of your object, and then you make a new Fourier transform to go from the data to the images. So you are doing the first Fourier transform for the data processing, and the second Fourier transform for the image reconstruction. So in fact, this image and this image is the same. This is in the same plane. The problem is that here, of course, this is fringes with only two telescopes. But if you consider the direct image obtained with a large number of telescopes, you will get directly the image of the star. That's the future of interferometry, to go directly to the quantity, to the direct image. Because of course, with that kind of image obtained directly at the focus of an interferometer, you can make a lot and make integral field spectroscopy, for example. So, with a two-telescope interferometer, what do we see? This is the visibility function of a solar-type star with one solar radius at 10 parsec. And so you see that this is the contrast of the fringes as a function of the spatial frequency. So at the beginning, what you see here is the Fourier transform of the stellar disk. This is a stellar disk with a dim darkening disk. And this form is directly can be directly computed by the Fourier transform of a uniform disk. You see the star spots here. The star spots are quite low here on this kind of type of star. Convection is quite high. And you can see also, if you go to very, very faint visibility measurement, to information about about the magnetic field. On a giant star, you see that the measurement of the stellar disk can be perturbated by star spot or active region, and you see that the importance of convection is very high. So that's the way of computing, in fact, or thinking in terms of kind of observation you want to do with an interferometer. With a differential phase here, for example, if I have a rotating star that I'm looking at the image of the star here for small spectral band in a absorption line. So in fact, if I look at the velocity field of the star is looking very differently when you look in the small spectral band, because of the Baker shift. Of course, in the continuum, you will see the star always, always black. And here, you see the difference of signal of visibility and phase as a function of the wave of the the velocity in the line for different kind of rotation for stars. So that's a way of measuring the rotation of stars. So at the end, what do we have? In fact, we have when you want to consider interferometric observation, you have to think in terms of your object, of course, but of, in terms of the way you will sample the things. And everything, in fact, what do you do? Everything is in this vector, the baseline, projected baseline over the wavelength. So the projected baseline is very important to consider the projected, because as the Earth is rotating, the projected baseline is changing, and the wavelength. So you can sample different things like that, and that's the way you are designing an interferometric observation. So as a first intermediate summary, I tell you that interferometer is quite simple. It's an imaging telescope with a diluted mirror. The imaging properties are highly dependent on the dilution and our ability to maintain the coherence. And what is really important is that in terms of future interferometric program, you have to think in terms of brightness distribution, images, and of course with you have to think the way you will have the better sampling of your information. And you will see also that most frequently complementary data, especially in spectroscopy, are so I will now go, I don't know if you have questions on this part. I finish after that with a few slides on the history of interferometry, which is a different topic, but we can discuss and continue after that. So the principle is coming from the famous experiment of Thomas Young in the beginning of the 19th century. With these famous Young fringes, with the possibility of doing constructive fringes or destructive fringes, either with the definition of the of interferometry has been in fact obtained by Hippolyte Fizeau in 1851, where he described in fact the fact that the properties of this is in French because it was published in French. There is a remarkable relation. Oh, I'm sorry. Can I stop this? Okay, there is a remarkable relation between the dimension of fringes and the dimension of the light source. That's something that was understood by Hippolyte Fizeau. And he says at the end of his paper, sorry about that, that it will be possible in the future to obtain new data on the angular diameter of stars. And he proposed, in fact, two experiments in his paper. Here with a two slit on the intrans lens of a refractor, and here a drawing designing in fact the Michelson experiment on the Morrison Observatory. So the first step was obtained by Stefan in the Observatoire de Marseille. He put a screen on the intrans of the 65 centimeter telescope on the Observatoire de Marseille, and of course what he says is that I always obtain fringes, and very bright fringes, in fact, because, in fact, what he says at the end is that the apparent diameter of star is very, very small, and much smaller than this angular resolution of this stage. So that's the first stellar fringes without result. The first interferometric measurement of angular diameter was done by Michelson on the Leak, at the Leak Observatory on the with this refractor of 30 centimeters, where he was able to measure the angular diameter. Oh, I'm sorry about that. Forget to change that. He was using this 30 centimeters. Oh. was using this 30 centimeter refractor with a very nice system with two slits with a variable separation. And what is detected at the beginning is that when looking at the star, this is drawing by Michelson. When looking at the star, you see this kind of images, and when looking at the, one of the satellites of Jupiter, you see that the central disk is larger than on the star. So, in fact, doing such observation here was possible it was able to detect where the fringes disappear for these four satellites. And he was able to measure the separation of the slit here for the four satellites, and it gave, in fact, the direct information of the angular diameter of the satellite. So it was done in 1891. After that, there has been a few intermediate steps by Anderson, also in the Morrison Observatory, with the rotating eyepiece interferometer, which was mainly made for determining orbits of binary. Again, here some work on the Morrison Observatory, the Andretti-Hitch telescope, with in fact this slit, the entrance of the telescope. This was done also by Michelson and Anderson, and there was the first measurement of the visual orbit of Capella in 1920. So after that, the big step was done, of course, by Michelson with the famous Michelson Stellar Interferometer. This 20 feet support on top of the Andretti-Hitch telescope, and he was able to observe the star Betelgeuse in August 1920, and he was able to determine that the fringe disappeared for a baseline of 3 meters, typically 3 meters, which give an angular diameter of 47 milliarcseconds, which is a very good agreement with the computed value. And in fact, it was the first interferometric measurement of the stellar angular diameter. So after that, there has been a series of observations. Not so much, in fact, because after that, they tried to go to a 50 feet interferometer on Mount Wilson, which was not successful. And after that, there was the 1929 crisis, the Second World War, and not so much development after that. And there was a revival of optical interferometry in 1963 by the concept of intensity interferometry in Narawi. So the colleagues Hanbury Bond, John Davis, and Mike Allen, they were using two light collectors of 6.5 meter telescope with photo multiplicators here. And they were able to make the concept of intensity interferometer. But they got some results, but the sensitivity was very poor, and they got a quite nice precision on 32 whole stars, and also on close binary. There was, after that, some attempt to develop a new version of the Michelson stellar interferometer that was not usually known by Kulagin and Linick. It was done on the Pulkovo Observatory, and they were able to make a nice visual measurement of the orbit of Capella. Okay. The major step was done by Antoine Lavery in 1974 in Nice Observatory with these two separate telescopes, and the possibility of measuring fringes on Vega with two separate telescopes. That was preliminary things on the I2T. There was a mechanical system on training driving the table here for compensation. There was no delay line, but the whole table was moving inside the benches. And after that, there was been this development on the cathode column with Antoine Lavery and myself for the GI2T interferometer with two 1.5 meter telescopes. And a spectrograph, and that was this part of this instrument when we closed it in 2005 that has generated the Vega instrument that is installed on the Morrison Observatory. And the scientific results have been obtained on the GI2T, either in the visible domain or in the infrared. And in the visible, we have mainly used the combination, in fact, of high angular resolution and spectral resolution. For that. And this is a global view of the interferometer of the late 20th century. With at that time, there was a lot of development all over the world. There was an interferometer in the UK, four or five interferometer in the US. There was also in Australia, the GI2T. There was a period where there was a lot of development, and I will speak more tomorrow about the current interferometer that are working now with the VLTI, mainly the VLTI and the CHAR. So that's probably all for today. I think I will stop here.
Thank you very much, Denis. Any question?
Yeah, about the delay lines you mentioned, those delay lines are designed to avoid necessary phase difference, or?
Yeah, it's because in fact when the star is moving in the sky, the telescope are fixed on the ground, so the position of fringes is changing during time. So you need to compensate the delay, and you need to compensate by at a speed of typically 1 millimeter per second, and you need to reach a precision of motion that is typically of 10 nanometer. So there is usually a free level of servo control for the delay line. There is a carriage rolling on rails first with a motor. Then there is a second level with a voice coil for very, very small correction. And then the third level on the secondary mirror of the CATS-A, of the optic system, with a very short stroke with PZT, piezoelectric system for correcting very fine beauty. And these systems are working very well either on the VLTI or on the shower array. This is exactly the same design, in fact, and reach speed of a few millimeters per second with an accuracy of 5 to 10 nanometers. And you need that for compensating the delay.
So at the beginning you said there was almost no way of recording the complex wave state of the light in the optical. Is that going to be tomorrow's talk? Like what? It's not no, there's almost no way. So can you speak a little bit more about that?
It's because of the wavelengths and the current time of the electromagnetic wave in the optical domain, which is with the current time of 10 to the minus 14. So recording that is for the moment almost impossible. There are some discussion about a way of doing quantum optics in the future. People are working in lab for the moment on that things, and that may be a solution at the end. That would be very, very, very welcome because, as you have seen, this is a huge complexity of transporting the beam from the telescope to the central station. So there was some attempt to do heterodyne interferometry, which is probably not completely close, in fact, because when it was done at the beginning, it was done with a very narrow spectral bandwidth that was highly limiting the sensitivity. But today we know solution for multiplexing, in fact, things, and having a large number of spectral channels. This is done, for example, in the millimetric domain. So that's way of probably. But for the moment, we are really in favor of direct interferometry.